Good morning, everybody. Or is it indeed? Yep. Welcome to this session. Some of you may have been at the Mark and Claire double act last year. We're going to try to be as exciting today. I'd like somebody, please, just to hand out these envelopes around to everybody in the room. You are not to open them until I say so. So, welcome. I am Mark Pemberton. I want to start with a quick disclaimer. Although I am director of the Association of British Orchestras, nothing I say today has anything to do with the Association of British Orchestras.
And the same would go for Trinity, yep. Love.
This is entirely in a personal capacity. This is going to be interactive, so prepare yourselves. Also, if you leave at any point between now and the end of this session, your business will collapse. So, let's start. That's no way to run a business. I want to start with this. You have a quick read of that statement. Would anybody like to tell me when they think that was written? That was in 1902. More than 100 years ago, they predicted that orchestras would be able to start making money. What fools they were. Frankly, all we can draw from this is it was ever thus. The classical music business model remains a mystery to those who work outside our industry. And it is frequently the case that successful business people join the boards of orchestras and other organizations and are completely baffled that we operate on the basic principle that every concert loses money. Are there not enough to go around? Well, it all will become clear later. So these businessmen come and they say, that's no way to run a business. You're doing it all wrong. But finding an alternative is easier said than done. Now, in his influential study from 1966, this gentleman, the economist William Baumol, invented the term cost disease. Using the example of a string quartet, he set out to show that there are some industries that simply cannot avoid persistent operating deficits. In short, commercial businesses increase their profitability through gains in productivity. But a Beethoven string quartet needs the same number of musicians today as it did when it was written. And the same principle applies to orchestras. And the problem of persistent deficits is a consequence of wage inflation. As salaries across the public and private sectors go up, so do they in the not-for-profit sectors. And this is exacerbated in our industry due to the fact that musicians we rely on a trained, highly skilled workforce where the musician's expertise carries a premium. But an orchestra's sources of income struggle to match the increases in labor costs. And its main source of income, therefore, inevitably would have to rise by the same percentage as the labor costs to avoid cost disease and a slide into deficit. So, well, how do we end up with some of that? How do we increase our income to meet our deficit? Well, there is government funding. Hey, well, in a couple of enlightened countries in Europe, that's staying stable or even going up. But in most countries in Europe, as we know, it's being cut. And all it does by cutting the public funding is you increase the structural deficit. Could we earn more? Is there earning potential in what we do? Ticket pricing. Well, it's market sensitive. And at the risk of stating the obvious, though I get to talk to politicians, both left-wing and right-wing, who do not understand this, charging the customer 100% of the cost of the concert would mean there would be nobody in the audience, because it would simply be too expensive. and making concerts more expensive would also run counter to our ambition to get a younger and more diverse audience into the concert hall. And what about touring? Could we tour more? Well, promoters are also feeling the squeeze. They've got less money, so there's less money going into the industry. And what about fundraising? Politicians love talking fundraising. Go out and talk to businesses. Go and talk to rich people. Well, it can make a marginal difference, but it's never going to be enough. It starts from a very low base to plug those big gaps in the structural deficit. And also, they tend to like their money to be spent on education, cattle campaigns. They don't tend to want the money spent on the day-to-day business of running concerts. And we've also, of course, got the politicians also talk a lot about new technology. Couldn't you use new technology to make money? Well, you know, does live streaming provide an additional revenue stream? Well, no. I would contend it doesn't. What it does do is it helps extend reach. Especially when politicians ask us, on the one hand, we should be using new technology to make money, and on the other hand, we should be giving it away for free. That conundrum we are unable to crack. So new technology, it extends reach, it engages a new audience, but it's limited application as an income generator in an age when young people expect everything on the internet to cost them nothing. So the question is there a genuinely new business model that could be the salvation of the contemporary orchestra? But it's not just orchestras that are losing money. Talk to the record labels. Who's making money in the record business? Their business model is being undermined by illegal downloading and the shift to streaming. And orchestras and artists are increasingly having to contribute to the cost of making a recording if they're going to get anything out there in the marketplace. The publishers tell us they're not making any money either. Big name composers are coming out of copyright, and their money is tied up in hundreds of thousands of printed scores. And what about our good friends, the agents? Some of their top artists may be making some money, but they tell us they've got lots of less starry artists on their books who are struggling to earn a living at all. Which begs the question, if none of us are making any money, who the hell is? Right, so to leaven the mood, we're going to play a quick game, which is where our envelopes come into play. We're going to play Wheel of Fortune. I would like everybody now to open their, those who have an envelope, please open it.
Those of you who don't have a seat, there's a whole lot of seats down the front here, come so to please the front. Do come and sit down.
In some of these envelopes is a lucky golden ticket. Yay, golden ticket, right, okay. Who's got golden tickets?
No. Only the people at the
front. How do they all be at the front? Okay, right. Okay, now this is where it gets interesting technologically. Right, click to spin. Okay, here we go. Hold up, I want one person with their golden ticket. Right, here we go. We're going to click to spin. You've got a business idea. Yep, you want to make money. Can you think off the top of your head, what would be a business idea you'd like to make money on?
Getting people to concert visitors to my CD web shop.
Okay, it's a CD web shop. Let's see this as a business proposition. Oh no, you've only made £1,000. Oh, I'm sorry. Sorry. Okay, who's next? Who's next? Stephen, you had one. What's your business idea?
I want to export the knowledge of my organization more widely in Europe.
Okay, let's see. Well, how's that gonna work? £10,000?
10 million. 10,000.
10,000. Okay.
Vic will be very pleased. I'll leave the text to him.
Okay. Joe, you've got one. Okay, what's your business idea?
Get an orchestra and happen to put on a lot of small concerts in people's homes that they all pay.
Okay, let's see. Is he going to... Round and round she goes. Where she stops, nobody knows. Oh, no! You're bankrupt! Oh, no! Again! You see, it's a lottery out there. Okay, who did one more? One more, right. Okay, what's your business idea?
What I'm still doing today, the old way of selling CDs without any webshop.
Okay. I really hope you win £10 million. A million? That's pretty good. Okay.
Not that good, but it's not far from that.
Okay. Right. Well, I think that's probably, unless anybody desperately wants to have a go and see if they're bankrupt, we'll probably move on. But, you know, it is a little point that it is, to some extent, potentially a little bit risky. You know, it is a lottery. Of course, you know, there could be a £10 million winner among in this room. Let's hope so. But there could also be some bankruptcies. So that's a happy thing to... So I'm now going to hand over to my esteemed colleague, Claire, who is going to actually give you some pointers as to where perhaps we might be able to begin to redirect our efforts to making more money.
Okay, now, I need to apologise. For those of you who know me, you know I don't normally sound like this. For those of you who don't, I don't normally sound like this. You'll have to forgive me as my voice fades in and out. So, we're going to start with a little video clip. You had a little taster there. I make no apologies for what I'm showing you, and there will be questions at the end, so pay a lot of attention. Look for everything.
Gondolieri di Venezia!
Okay, now I won't subject you to any more of this, but before we talk about what's on the screen, tell me what you've seen. Hands up.
Please. Thousands of happy people.
Thousands of happy people watching who? On GVO. Okay, what else, Joe?
Lots of close-ups of people having a deep relationship with
music and the person. And the
yeah, anything anybody can tell me about the people? What did you notice about the people that were shown in the audience?
Broad range of ages. They closed up on a young couple. There were the pensioners that were there. And while I may have smiled at it ironically, they were genuinely into the romance of the moment.
Absolutely. Johannes?
Lots of, like, the orchestra was dressed up in costumes. They had additional props, such as the gondola.
It's a particularly attractive gondola, absolutely.
Yes, well, and the sort of show on stage of Andre walking away and making fun of himself.
Absolutely. Sorry, the gentleman behind.
They weren't communicating with God via great art. They were being entertained.
Yeah, absolutely, yes.
I don't have a problem with it, but I saw that kitsch is still alive.
Absolutely, and popular. Anything else? Yes, Stephen.
It wasn't really about the music, was it? It was about the total experience, and the music was simply there to help facilitate that.
Interesting idea. Yes, please.
Wide range of nationalities.
Wide range of nationalities, very pointed little shot of the flag. Yes, please.
That's entertainment.
Absolutely. That's entertainment. Yes, over here. No? Anybody else? Yes, Bryn.
A big risk to set up something like that with so many people. And if it doesn't sell, they'd go bankrupt, which I think they always
do. Well, they did, actually, at one point, and then he pulled it back from the brink. Now, I think the thing with André Rieu, now, often when you take an extreme example of something, it provides a very, very good case study to analyse, because you look at the component elements of what they've done, and then you ask yourself the question, what could you do with this? Now, we all know about André Rieu, and what set me down this track was a chance conversation with the managing editor of Classic FM. He told me that André Rieu, and you probably saw there, that was filmed at his soundstage in Maastricht. He also has one in Brazil, which he has built from scratch, and we'll come back to that in the beginning a bit later. But André Rieu uses a 30-camera setup to film those concerts. And do you know why he uses a 30-camera setup? Because he's not using them all to get different shots that you see. 9 of them are shots of the orchestra, and the other 21 are shots of the audience. And most of the shots of the audience are never used. It's not so that he's got more variety of shots of the audience. He sits down with them, and this is really thinking about him as a musician and as a businessman. He analyzes those 21 camera reels in infinite detail, looking at his audience, looking at the reactions. He apparently never repeats anything that hasn't worked. If there was a negative reaction in any way, he removes that element from the performance. So absolutely everything that's happening on the stage, not just the costumes and the kind of trite scenery, is fundamentally controlled through product control. And what's interesting, if you look at this particular example, what you've got here is an opportunity, if you go onto André Rieu's website, to sign up to be an official André Rieu photographer. If you notice, if you're selected, you have to fill in an application form. If you're selected, and presumably quite a lot of people put themselves forward, you'll receive a brand new Nikon Coolpix camera. In addition, you'll be given a pair of tickets for great seats at the concert and a tour programme signed by him. The photo chosen as best photo will be printed on canvas, sent to the photographer. Photos that you have taken will be put on the Facebook page. They'll be put and shared with other fans. But why he's doing this, if you imagine, if you select demographically from the people who apply, and people will apply for lots of different reasons. Some will because they're fans, and some will because they want a camera, and some will because it sounds like a fun thing to do. It's a bit like going to a wedding and there being cameras on the table. Actually, what you get, and especially where he's saying the person has to take photos, if you look further up, you get the camera to take photos before and during the concert, not just during the concert, before and during. Why do you want to look at what your audience looks like before the concert? Well, you're finding out lots of things about them. You're finding out what clothes they're wearing, what bags they've got, what food they're eating, what watch they've got. Do they have a coat on? Are they in small groups with friends? Who are they chatting to? Who demographically are they associating themselves with? You notice the young couple in the film had a flag. For sure, they did not bring that flag to the concert. Somebody gave them that flag, and it was positioned there so that they were tagged as wanting to associate themselves with another country. So that there's this sort of sense of globalism It happened to be an Italian flag, but if you watch a lot of these videos, which sadly in preparation for this I did, there are lots of flags of lots of different countries. Andre Euro's business is a very interesting business because, as somebody said, he went bankrupt. He tried this, he didn't get the product right, but he didn't walk away, he tried again, and he's learned an awful lot about being a businessman along the way. This is nothing to do with Andre Euro. Harmony Parlor is the fan site, one of the English language fan site for Andre Euro. It's a blog which is run by John and Suzanne, who are a couple in their 50s from Middle England. And they blog on a very regular basis. They have things like English translations of every interview ever given if it's not in the English language in the first place. They have lots of photos. They have conversations with other fans. So, for example, the set in Maastricht, I think, was rebuilt not that long ago. A group of the fans went and stayed in a hotel overlooking the site for 3 weeks while the site was rebuilt and blogged on a daily basis and posted photos of cranes, and other people who weren't there posted in saying how jealous they were that the site was being rebuilt and they weren't there to see it being done and how they couldn't wait to see what it looked like when it was finished. But Andre Euro gives those fans, John and Suzanne, privileged access to him. So they get periodically to interview him. They get access to family photographs, intimate things about him, things that give you a completely different insight into who Andre Euro is as a person. I think those of you who've looked at him may know that he's got, I think it's either his brother or his son is a painter. His wife is very much part of the family. The whole thing is created into this sense of there being a close family community, a close community with his ensemble. He used to, I think he employs currently about 95 people, but it was until recently in about 130. And then this community of fans, which expands itself out in different contexts. Now this one made me laugh. It went under this heading, something like science proves that Andre Euro, you know, is exceptional. But what's interesting, if you look at what people are saying, I think it's particularly quite revealing that I don't know the scientists, I don't know which institution they're associated with, they're social scientists, not scientists as in chemists, that kind of thing. But what it reflects is actually what a lot of us might feel, which is that your instinctive response might be to feel that it's all a bit trite or a bit kitsch or not real music. But actually when you look at what he's achieving, it says in the last paragraph, the show starts with a climax with Andre Euro and his musicians enter through the audience to the music of 76 trombones. So there is music being piped in and they walk in. So it's very much about, it's, if you think about the way that rock and pop are done, there's a lot of the strategies that are employed in rock and pop. And the last sentence there, you know, look at, you can't understand culture if you're not open to the popular segment. And this question of segment, I think, is the thing that really underpins the question that we wanted to put back to you today. Do you understand who your audience is? But do you think of your audience as a kind of mass audience, or do you break them down? And if you break them down, do you break them down into the obvious kind of things? So you'll do family concerts, and you might do concerts for pre-fives, or you'll do lunchtime concerts because they're quite good for older people, or something like that. To what degree have you really taken ownership of your understanding of your audience? Because for sure, the big recording companies and the big successful brands do brand audience segmentation and analysis of the associations and different things, elements that an audience wishes to associate themselves with, and feeds all that knowledge into their portrayal of their product. So a business model which describes the rationale of how an organization creates, delivers, and captures value. If you don't know what the value of what you do is to the person you're doing it to, or giving it to, or selling it to, then your product doesn't necessarily have value. You have to understand what that value is to them. It's not your knowledge, it's your understanding of their understanding of the value. So the work of Alexander Osterfelder, and if anybody's interested, I've got a couple of copies of these books here, is very, very interesting. Looks at value propositions. And there's a couple of particular exemplars that I think we can draw on in looking at this. He talks in particular about audience segmentation and about value proposition design. And this is an example of the work that they've been doing. They work with a lot of big multinationals, and they did a big project. They do visual representations of the mind maps they do with teams when they're brainstorming around this. And this is the one for YouTube, just as an example. What lies behind this is a series of organized thinking about the value proposition, looking at the audience in every dimension and the product, and trying to look at whether there's alignment between the product that they're designing and the audience that they're trying to target it at. I think if we think about classical music, one of the things we're terribly guilty of doing, because of the nature of the classical music business model and because of the nature of going into big venues, often concert halls with an orchestra particularly, I think probably in a way an orchestra or an opera company or big company is the least flexible. The smaller you are, the more flexible you can be. But is that we have a product and then we find it very hard actually to map it. You know, we get asked all the time by funders, by government, by other people, why do different audience demographics not come to our concerts? But the fact is that the concert format basically only works for, if you're lucky, 7% of the population, probably less. So actually, the audience that you can target with any given format is very small. So the whole principle of the value proposition is that there are things that the audience thinks and knows it wants, or the customer thinks and knows it wants, but then there's also the idea of disruptive innovation. So that's when you give the audience something they don't think or know that they want, but actually they discover it's very exciting or very much for them, and they start moving in a new direction. And I think a lot of what we're talking about at Classical Next is about looking at what those disruptive innovations might be. And I think the question of the audience or customer segment, I'm not sure, I'm afraid this slide doesn't come out very clearly, but what you can see there, they're talking about the audience are reached through different distribution channels that require different types of relationships. They have substantially different types of possibilities and profiles. They're willing to pay for different aspects of the offer, and I think that's an interesting thing. You know, there's a big rise in popular culture of events where people are enabled to pay what they want to pay, not what they have to pay. And that leads to some very interesting behaviours, which tells you a lot about value and what's placed on what value is placed on your product by different parts of your audience. Now, in the UK, there's been a lot of work done on a national level looking at audiences, in particular a big project, which I think was 2011 this was first published, called Arts Audiences Insight. And what it gives you is a kind of generic audience segmentation of the UK audience. This is actually an English audience, I should stress. I can say I'm not English, I'm Scottish. It's a very important difference. And I'm not a nationalist. So the highly engaged, as you can see, are only 7% of the population, the urban arts eclectic and the traditional culture vultures. There's quite a big demographic group proportionally, that's another 27% who are not culturally engaged at all. And then there's the people in the middle. This is a model, is a useful model. I would argue it's a massively limited model, because what it doesn't do, when you actually drill down, I don't think I've got the slide with the information, but when you drill down, yeah, this is a different model, you don't get that sense of what the people who fall into those segments want to associate themselves with. So the very detailed brand mapping, you get that very high level. And I think that while there's been some work done in the classical sector, in the arts sector, looking at audience segmentation, it does not go to the level of detail. Some of the recording companies do it, but on the whole, we don't do it. And you know, it sounds like it's going to be a big exercise. It is not a big exercise to do. You can do it through very clever little tricks like what André Rieu has used. You know, if you gave your audience cameras, just think about your audience and whatever organization you're in. If you gave them, if you asked them questions, if you looked at them, if you have monitors standing watching them as they came in, monitoring the different groups that they're in. Lots of social scientists do things like just go out in the street and talk to different demographic groups of people and ask for their reaction. You can do those activities yourselves with a very, very small staff base, with a dedicated week of activities looking at it. That's a different methodology. I can't remember now what that one's called. Joe, remind me, that's the new one. The audience spectrum, which is a new, slightly different version. But again, it has similar properties. But what's interesting is this is the audience spectrum analysis of the classical music market. If you look at, it derives from a big, I don't know if this has got a light on the end of it. No. It derives from a big survey that was done that's done in UK called Taking Part. It says 8% of the population say they've attended a classical music event at least once in the last year. That was 92% who haven't. So first of all, the 8% are not persistent attenders. Only a very tiny proportion of those are persistent attenders, maybe 3% of 8%. At most 7% of 8%, and everybody else is attending infrequently or not at all. So, let's look at a different way of doing it. Who knows what League of Legends is? Hi. Yannis.
Online role play, you get to build characters and their teams of five, and they have world championships where they play for something stupid like $1 million.
Absolutely.
Internationally.
Absolutely, it's an international online gaming platform. I think the online gaming platforms and video game world is a world that we should be looking at because they're doing some really interesting things. And the thing that they're particularly doing, I think it has two dimensions. One is that they're doing a lot of work looking at, and you can see just in the blue up at the top, their value proposition, their customer relationships, and their customer segments. They're trying to understand very much what the demographic of their particular audience is in a lot of detail. And they're trying to work out why that particular audience would engage with their game. But the other thing that they're doing that I think is a really interesting thing is they all have massive, what they call community programs. Every single one of the online games has a massive community program. Now this particular example talks about, if you see the first one, community events, so officially endorsed tournaments, leagues, viewing parties. Viewing parties, so where you go to someone's house to watch other people playing the game. Meetups and more, so that's a way, so it's a different kind of social networking. Or the PC cafe, so again, you get to go to a place to get people together. But my brother-in-law was the one that really introduced me to this. My brother-in-law is a PhD in chemistry, works as in a nanotechnology company. And what he does in his spare time is play a game called EVE Online. And a few weeks ago, he and my sister-in-law, I should say they're quite a lot younger than I am, went off to Iceland for a week to an EVE Online community event in Iceland. There were over 2,000 people there. It was a full conference of three to five days, I can't remember exactly, with a spectacularly packed conference program. It had a sub-program for the other halves of the non-gamers who were there. And it included presentations from the CEO, from the creative teams for every dimension of the game, and it was a kind of sandbox for the company where they were looking at prototyping and testing ideas and looking for masses of amounts of input from their community about what the product is, how it was developing. Another interesting example is Lego. Lego have done a very interesting initiative where they have said, okay, you know what the building blocks of Lego are? Why don't we give you, sort of particularly passionate advocates of Lego or users of Lego, we'll give you the chance to design new products. And a very, very small number of those products will be launched for a kind of premium price, niche luxury product for other passionate advocates to buy. And if any of them prove successful, they then go into the mass market. So what they're doing is they're allowing the IP, the ownership of the ideas, to move away from the central management team, not even just into the core team, but actually beyond the organization. So it's a kind of open source developmental process. Now, you know, I know if you imagine if you were an orchestra and you went to your audience and said, okay, you know, let's design a concert program. That's an interesting tool to try. Why not have a competition? Get people to design concert programs, maybe the best one that gets performed in the next season. But you find out an awful lot along the way about the kind of programming that appeals to your audience. You could, funnily enough, in the plane, Mark, could you just grab me the magazine that's at the bottom there? On the plane over, British Airways magazine High Life had a big article about SoFar, which is a company, I don't know if Brendan knows about it, but he do after dark kind of idea. So you sign up onto the SoFar website, and if you're selected, you can run an event in your house, and if you're selected differently, you can get to be one of the people who goes to that event. And they do it through popular music, small groups, small ensembles, but they want a space that will house up to 100 people. So they use it as a brand launch platform for small contemporary ensembles, pop, jazz, rock, but actually, why can't we do it with classical? So, we've got a few questions for you. We'd like to split you up into groups. Now, there are so many of you, which we weren't quite expecting. We might even need to go for more than four groups, Mark,
I
think.
It's so fantastic there are so many people. It's completely wrong-footed us. So, how should we play this then? Six?
I reckon six. Those of you who don't have a seat, come and cluster with people who do. If you could sort of have a cluster in front of the barrier on this side.
Yep, so create clusters.
Cluster, yeah.
There, middle,
and
front,
back.
Front. Yep, back, middle, front. Four questions. You don't have to answer all four. You might want to take one and give it a really good thumping. Or you might want to do two, or you might want to do all four. It's completely up to that group. Each group will need to nominate somebody who's going to stand up and tell us something interesting that came out of that conversation. And we will then be able to feed that into some declaration of intent at the end.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Thank
okay.
you very much.
So, on your marks, create your clusters. Claire and I will be walking around. We'll be helping you and tuning into
Trying.
Your conversation. Right.
I agree entirely.
Okay, may I have your attention? I'm going to select some groups at random to see whether you'd like to tell us something about your conversation. This group here, would you like to give us a very quick summary of, you know, just one thing you've been talking about that's been the most interesting thing? And project.
We had a nice conversation. Couldn't answer, like, you know, 100% of every question, and we don't have the good recipes for that. In other way, we wouldn't discuss all that things. But what could we discuss a lot about the first question, and we are so different here, and concert halls, and on orchestras, and ensembles, and seven radios. And but we need there was a proposition. Much more personal communication with our audience and customer-based programming or discussions or communication with the audience. And of course, it's been talked a lot about digital ways of communication. So as in classical music works. We discussed about number four. What do you need to do to help your business grow? It's also more customer-based products that can, we speak about financial growth. So that's Andre Prio, of course, is a good example on that, but we are so different there, but it's not a solution for everyone.
Thank you. Brilliant. Thank you very much indeed. Great. Sorry to pick on you first. That was to get the conversation going. I'd now like another group. Would somebody from a group like to stand up and tell us? Oh, Brendan, imagine my surprise.
We mainly discussed the second point on how would you segment your audience. And the first thing we came across very quickly was actually, well, we have marketing departments who do that, but that's demographically. And is that still to the point today? And then we actually focused a little bit on the how would we actually segment it? How can we do it? And we had an experienced guy in our group as well who says, like, the big companies now, they actually don't do demography anymore, but they focus on lifestyle and use elements from that. All the data you can gather, and there's so much data we can gather, you can put that together and create and decide on new communities. Because in that segmentation, we also came to the conclusion that we tend to say either we want our specialist audience or we want everybody to come to the concert hall, whilst in fact, with the experience of some others, it doesn't work that way because not every group or community is comfortable with the other community. Does that then mean that you've got to make more efforts to do different things for all these communities? Yes, or just to dare to focus on your community of choice.
Thank you very much indeed. Great. So, lots of good talking there about segmentation. I'm really pleased about that. Run another group. Yes, Jordan.
We had lots of beautiful examples. 4,000 people in the square outside the concert hall in Gran Canaria, for example. Children's concerts in Lucerne, which bring in a particular sector. The big question from the Conservatoire is how do you make the different constituent fan groups talk to each other?
Uh-huh.
And I think this is going to be a topic that maybe could be spread around.
Claire, any ideas?
There are some things that I could come back to at the end of the yeah.
And also to finish in the Canadian Association, they are looking at a lot of different analysis systems in order to actually, like you would describe, to get to the bottom of who everyone actually is.
Great. Well, that will be stolen by the Association of British Orchestras when that's done.
The idea of the funk idea, which is coming out with De Luna and Kodals Rotterdam next door, which is to ask a city panel plus students to create from black sheets programming the whole thing.
Great. And let's have another one.
Good example.
Yeah.
We talked largely about number one, so we've got to go with a few different things. So Andre Ruet is already famous, so that
but he once wasn't.
Exactly, but there's thousands and thousands of young artists who've been with high school trainings aren't, and I suppose can everybody be famous? They need to enlarge their world, but we also thought, talking about quality, how do you define quality? Placing music apart, discussing groups like successful groups like the Kronos and how do they engage the audience. Audience segmentation. Audiences don't care about segmentation, but marketers do, and I think that's really and the way that it's really inspiring is the way you get building communities of people. So fantastic idea about how could you do that? Well, an orchestra or an ensemble could invite people to write program notes. And you don't even need to have one program note, you could have lots of program notes, or you could select some, there's some editing. And then there's some fantastic ideas about the actual the record shop, and a lot about curation in a world where there's just like so much information. How do you Spotify's free, but it's full of stuff. If you put in romantic piano, because you don't know those artists, you actually get one of our last students who records a new romantic piano playlist every 3 months. He's doing very well out of it because people put in romantic piano. But it's the idea of curating and sort of help guide people in music. So,
great. Thank you. I think we've got time just for one more, and then we must wrap up because we've been kicked out of this room. Any other group would like to say yes, please?
Yeah. We talked a lot about the first one as well.
Yes, stand up. Yeah.
And we came to we remember an experience where we got 1 hour. We asked musicians from a group of musicians to bring us 1 hour of their time every week or every 2 weeks, and then we opened a Facebook group, and then we just asked questions. I think that's the best way to create communities, to just ask as opposed to just give. So we start to say, what would you like to happen for music in your city? And people start saying, oh, I would love to have a concert for my kids. And musicians who would say, oh, I will give you 6 minutes of my time, would go there and say, oh, I can go. And then the community start building up, and now it's like 12,000 people are doing this kind of interaction with them. And then we thought, well, what if through music we can give something that is useful for people? And we start saying, oh, I can teach you how to code through music. So then the coders came to the group and so on, so they separated in a separate group where kids will analyze, like, for example, the spectrogram of the sound of the violin, and then explain them the science behind it. So we give them into music. So the conclusion is, I guess, is that it's through questions.
Right.
It's just having the humbleness to listen to our audience.
That's a really lovely point at which
to
wrap things up. Claire, would you like to?
Yeah, I mean, I think in a sense that for me comes back to the question of the kind of what in the gaming world would be called open source product development. the idea of actually taking it out to your audience. I mean, in the world that is very globalized and is very focused on the internet, we know, and it's come out through lots of the conversations I've listened into, that actually what everybody wants is a personalized and real experience that they are truly engaged with. Sometimes they just want to drop in and consume, but actually that's part of the lifestyle choice. And so really understanding and talking to your audience, but also talking to your wider colleagues, not just the management team, but what they understand about people's behaviors and reactions is, I think, the key to all of this. I mean, there are so many ideas. There are so many great ideas that I've heard in the room. I heard somebody talking about pizza, pizza before concerts. Invite everyone for pizza and then they go and watch the concert. Well, you know, why not? And the idea of within a local community of building that community from the inside out, connecting the communities up by crossover activities where they are both interested to come together, which could be sharing a pizza, or it could be colleagues from the Philharmonia Orchestra who played at a big gaming convention. They took the orchestra to the gaming convention, people played the games, the film was on screen, and the orchestra were there playing. And that connecting communities is part of the solution as well.
Great. So thank you all. It's been a fantastic, fantastic hour. The conversation doesn't stop here. Keep it going. Keep talking. We're here around. So you've got us to hand. So what's the way to run your business? It's all about the customer. Thank you very much indeed.